Hi, I'm Fred McNeil, and thank you for watching QACTV 7. You're watching a show called Conversations with Fred, and this is education time. Time to get those pencils and pens, get the laptops ready, and hey, go and buy yourself some clothes for those kids. That's my favorite thing to think about going back to school. I'm real lucky. I've got a whole delegation from the Wye River Upper School today. They're going to tell you about the school, which most of us tragically don't know enough about. And I can attest to one fact. I see a number of their students walking by just about every day on the walks. They're the most polite kids I've ever seen. And someone who taught and was in administration, I've never seen 15 or 20 kids. They're not fussy, not throwing rocks in my windows or whatever. So congratulations before we start, okay? Ladies, how about introduce yourselves and tell us what your role is at school, please.
Sure. My name's Emma Rose Muma, and I'm the Director of Development, Wye River. Been there about 3 years.
Okay, thanks, Emma. Yes, ma'am?
My name's Nicole Sophocles. I'm the assistant head of school, and I've been working at Wye River.
And no gray hairs, Nicole. You're doing better than I am.
Well, I'm new to the position, so we'll see.
See you in 5 years. Right. Okay.
But I've been with the school about 18 years.
Oh, you've been there 18 years.
So, from the beginning.
Okay. Yeah. All right. And a hardworking teacher.
I'm Katie.
And I apologize for putting you at the end. I should normally put teachers up at the front. My mind just couldn't figure it out.
Oh, that's all right. I'm Katie Lillard, and I'm the art teacher at Wye River.
Okay.
So I'm headed into my fourth year there.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Ladies, how about we start with this? We always like to end this show. Tell us a little bit about yourself, maybe where you're from, where you went to school. And I always wanted to know, what was the trigger that got you into education? And then we'll spend the majority of time on the school itself. But let the public know who you are and why in the world you want gray hairs like this one day or no. For education is the best job in the world, but it's also one of the most demanding in the world. So I'm sorry about it.
No problem. So I grew up in Annapolis, Maryland, okay. And I went to the Key School growing up all 12 years.
Where in Annapolis?
Just in Annapolis. Right over the Bay Bridge on the Annapolis side.
We lived for years in the South River.
Oh, okay.
And remember the old South River with the old police station on the corner? Yeah, we still live there. Okay.
Yeah, and after that, I actually became a professional ballet dancer.
You're kidding me, a ballet dancer.
I did, and so I did school online so that I could have my career that way, and so I went to Arizona State University for family.
Got out west for a while.
Yeah, for family and human development.
What was the trigger? I mean, what was the trigger? How did you go from ballet to development officer?
Well, I was part of a founding, or I was a founding member of a ballet company, and so I wanted to raise money for my friends and myself for a paycheck. So I did all the development work there, and when I moved back home this way, I actually knew of a student that went through Wye River, mm-hmm. and I had known her since she was a baby, and just watching her come out of high school, a totally different kid, I was like, what is going on at that school? Because that is something really special.
They're doing something right.
They're doing something really amazing. So, I came here, and I just kept going with development.
Okay, so I have a starving ballet teacher, and probably a starving teacher at the end, but we'll get there. Okay, pass the baton. How do you do it?
Sure. So I grew up right outside of New Orleans, Louisiana.
Oh, really? What a great town.
So it is. It is a great town. I went to school at University of Miami, and my undergrad was in marine science and biology. Mm-hmm. And I started to move more into environmental education and experiential learning outside. I worked on a boat for a while. So I ended up going back and getting my master's. More in education, and I like high school students. I like to get into the content
of things. They're almost like adults where they can talk to you.
So I started working at Wye River as a teacher, science and math teacher, and I started doing a little bit more administrative work as time went on, and I've stayed with it because I love working with students. I love working with other educators. Our school is small, so you really get to know the student, which is nice.
It's a nice thing. We'll get into your school in a couple of minutes. Yeah, you're only dealing, and you're going to later tell us the number of students, but it's nice to know everybody's name.
Yeah.
They know your name, and you know what? It makes it a lot closer family, right? Mm-hmm.
It's fun to learn, like, the high school students, like, what do they want to do, and what are their passions, and you can really find that out, and every day is kind of a different day,
which
I like, so it's not the same thing.
Well, we talked before we went, and when I ran the alternative school for the county, same thing, we were probably, I hate to admit it, 30 students or less. You knew everybody's name. Yeah. You knew Johnny liked sailing. You knew someone else liked with small engine repair. And it makes the whole system work a lot better, which is good. New Orleans, a quick New Orleans story.
Sure.
I went to the Final Four in New Orleans.
Okay.
I think the year Duke won it. And we went, and I'm trying to think, but the best thing was I'd run in the morning, 6 o'clock in the morning, through downtown New Orleans, a whole different world. They're cleaning out, and it's quiet, but a beautiful town, beautiful town.
It's a beautiful, beautiful city, a lot of culture.
Oh, it's good. Yeah. My starving art teacher, tell us
Hello.
What you're
doing. Hi. So I grew up in Middletown, Delaware.
Oh, okay,
actually.
Now the biggest boom town in the East Coast.
Oh, I know.
What have you done to my town?
I know. Yeah, it used to look a lot more like Centreville, actually.
Yeah, I can remember 40 years ago when we first moved here, taking my son to Little League soccer games in Middletown. It was, what, one stoplight and a soccer field.
Four corners.
Yeah, that was it.
Yeah.
Now it's a boomtown.
Yeah, so I grew up in Middletown, and I went to St. Andrew's School high school.
Great school.
Yeah, I had a great experience there. And I went to the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts for painting after high school. So I guess I just loved my high school experience. It's where I got into the studio. It's where I figured out that I was an artist and really had the time and freedom to explore there. So I still get to do that now as an art teacher.
In St. Andrews, I coached for a while at Gunston, soccer and basketball. Mm-hmm. We used to play you guys all the time, and you always beat us. I'm embarrassed to tell the school, but not only a great academic program, but great in athletics, right?
Yeah, great. Really, yeah, absolutely.
Well, I've got a very talented group here. I've got an Annapolitan. I have New Orleans. We've got Boom City person here, right? Now, ladies, tell us about, most of us, unfortunately, and I'm guilty too, the Wye River Upper School. I mean, I'm going to let you tell us where we are and the facilities and everything. But what's the mission? What's going on there? And why? And I don't think the county knows enough about it. So come on, any order you want. You guys do it any way you want.
Okay. So we are, an independent 501c3 organization.
It's a private school.
It's a private school. And we're in the heart of Centreville right here on Commerce Street.
The old armory.
In the old historic armory. And it's got so much history there.
It's got the best wooden basketball court. Yeah. I would have killed for
that. It does. Our founding head of school would be very happy for us to tell you we have the most gorgeous cherry floors that are historic, and the integrity is still there in the building. But we serve between 50 and 60 students, about 57 right now. And we pull from 9 Maryland and Delaware counties. So the students come from all over. We are not a boarding school, but we make our transportation really accessible. So, and the most important part about us is that we serve students with learning differences. So for those that aren't really sure what that means, it's ADHD, dyslexia, ADD, high-functioning autism. And so it's a really specialized school, and we work to be really responsive to these students' needs. And a lot of them come to us with these, kind of burdened with their past educational experiences. Right. Because
it hasn't been a good experience.
Yeah, I mean, they aren't... I think the word you hear more often now is neurodiverse, and we're all neurodiverse. We all think in different ways. And so these students, it's just a little bit more extreme for them. So we have a very uniquely supportive environment that really focuses on each individual student and what their needs are for them to thrive in an academic setting, socially, emotionally, academically.
And you must be doing something, I said off the air, and I think I said at the beginning of the show, they walk by my house most mornings as polite as they can be, a lot of smiles on their faces, and whether they're looking birds, looking at cars, they're just happy kids.
Yeah.
They're doing something right, okay? And which is great.
Yeah, and I think that's a big part of the culture and the environment at school is there's, and part of it is, yes, we're so small that we can keep an eye on everybody, but the other part is that they are so respectful and understanding of each other's experience that there's just really not a bullying issue. It's a very inclusive.
It's a family. It's a big
family,
family
environment.
Right?
Yeah.
Family,
it's a big
community.
Family.
Mm-hmm.
How many staff members? Anyway, remember, I'm just going to throw out questions.
We have 11 teachers. We have 11 teaching staff.
11 teachers. That full time.
All full time.
Okay.
One of them also heads our athletic department.
Okay.
So not necessarily
so
teaching classes full time.
There's a sports program.
So there is a sports program. And then as far as like administrative and support staff, I think we're at 6.
Yeah, about 20 total. Yeah.
So okay. About around 20 total.
So you have good sized faculty.
Good sized faculty. Our sports program, so all of our, this is unique, all of our students start their day with physical activity.
Is that part of the walk I see in the morning?
That's what you see every morning.
That's what I see in the morning. Okay.
So yeah, all of our students start their day with physical activity. We know research tells us that, you know, high school starts super early. Sure. Most high schools start super early in the morning. And, you know, if you've ever had a high school student, getting them up to start a class at 7:30 a.m. is, you know, kind of tough. So we start our day with physical activity, and the students choose between something competitive like soccer or something for their own physical fitness.
Where do you all play soccer?
They play at the Queen Anne's County Parks and Rec.
Oh, we're going to use the public parks.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was going to say, I thought you were playing on a roof house.
Well, that would be cool.
So the day, someone take me through a typical day. I mean, I know, having been a teacher and administrator in Queen Anne's County, I mean, I'm not joking. When I taught health, I would start my 7:35 class. We'd all stand up and do calisthenics to get them awake.
Yeah,
so
they got to wake up.
Take me through it.
So students arrive just before 8 mm-hmm. and get ready for morning activities, which Nicole has just talked about a little bit. So morning activities last about an hour. So it's the first hour
of the day.
So the
day starts off with physical activities mm-hmm. for an hour. Mm-hmm. Okay, wake them up.
Good every idea. Day, all year, every student. And they have different activities they can choose between. So I think we've offered dance before, yoga. We've gone to the YMCA mm-hmm. many years
in
the wintertime.
There's a whole gamut of activities they can take.
Lots of activities to choose from in the morning. And then we meet for a little bit. We have morning announcements. Students grab something to eat so that they're fueled and ready. And then we go to class. Okay. We have a few classes.
Give me an academic. What classes do we have? I mean, we like the public school. You've got to have so many maths, so many histories. How do we do that?
Yeah, so we our graduation requirements, not identical necessarily to the public school system, right. But we meet the Maryland State Department of Education criteria. Okay. And, the students, we have a pretty well-developed art, music program. We can also talk a little bit about our makerspace building.
Okay.
So we're really well developed in the arts, but our students are taking English. Okay. They're taking a science. They're taking a social studies.
So the regular.
They're taking their regular academic.
4 day or
courses.
Four period day. So just like the public.
So block scheduling. Okay. 4 period day. Language. So.
So the real academic world, right?
Yes. Yeah. Okay.
Let me ask you, one of my favorite things, how about counseling staff? Is there people helping with counseling issues and,
Yeah, we do have, a counselor on site. She works with all our students. A lot of it is developing student activities, working on social skills as, you know, depending on their student needs. She'll design all school activities, things like that. But she also works with individual students or individual families as needed.
Yeah. Okay. You got me convinced. What was the art center? Were you beginning? I don't care who does. You do it and tell me about that.
Well, why don't you can speak about the art program in the makerspace?
Okay,
yeah,
sure.
Makerspace. Yeah, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. So Wye River actually has this new makerspace program. I guess we're going into our fourth year there too, because I came on as an art teacher as our older art teacher shifted to leading that. So it offers project-based learning for students where they sort of conceptualize something that they would like to create and then they have to figure out how to make it. And so the makerspace facilitates that process. And we also have some cool gizmos and tools for them to use to help them build bigger projects.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. The art program is traditional in offering painting and drawing and ceramics and printmaking, but we also do graphic art and some video editing and digital photography as well. So there's a lot for students to choose from. Mm-hmm. And all students do both. So okay. Freshmen come in and are required
to. So everyone takes art.
Everybody takes art. Everybody goes through the makerspace course too.
Now, how about testing? I mean, I know my wife retired this year, I think, because testing drove her crazy. Parents always, is there a state requirement for private schools too? How does that all work?
So there's not. So okay. There's not. And our students do some achievement testing in language, arts, and math so that our teachers can have an idea of where they are and how they're progressing with that. We do offer practice tests for college testing for the SAT and so forth like that. But we aren't required to, our main core content areas aren't required to take an assessment at the end that will, show whether or not they can graduate.
Right, right.
So we don't have that testing. We really, our teachers are not teaching to a test. They're teaching what our students
whatever
need to
the
learn.
Subject is, you can have that educational moment, which we've lost tragically in public schools, where you have to go, I can't get off. I've got to teach you this core information,
correct,
which is no fun.
Yeah.
I have to ask this question. I have to all of educators. How in the world did you get through last year? I mean, I had a wife who had retired, bless her heart, and rightfully so, said, Fred, this is the hardest challenge I've ever had as a teacher. How did you get through COVID? Why did the school do with the getting through COVID? Virtual learning, I assume, in-person learning. How did that all go?
Sure. Well, we did a little bit of everything.
Okay. Katie, she's so smart.
Katie can really talk about the classroom experience.
Okay. Okay.
Overall, I think, definitely it stretched all of us to doing something different and new, and that's obviously got pros and cons, and it's a challenge. But I think, we teamed together really well. And our students went with the flow of it, I think, really well. Considering everything going on.
Was the school ever closed? Was the school ever closed like the public schools where the kids went? I mean, did you have kids and we kept coming or what?
We had periods of time. We never needed to close for a quarantine or anything like that. But we did have periods of time after major holidays where we did go all remote that to help avoid transmission. Of students who might have been out of town.
It sounds like the staff and the students got through it, right?
So we all got through it, and I think, time will tell. I think they've learned, all of us learned some new skills.
Well, I tell everyone we have on the show, I think this year is gonna be the most challenging for educators. In the public sector, you basically have had kids who haven't been in school in a year plus.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden you're gonna say, hey, you can come back in school, we've got sets of rules, you've gotta do this. And the toughest thing with my grandchildren, they're going to have to get out of the bed at 6 o'clock in the morning.
Right.
And I think it's going to be a very challenging year for all of you and the students, right?
I think we mostly found our rhythm again at the end of last year or midway through the spring when we were back full time in person. But it was amazing to see how the students sort of held together as a community
online.
They
did, and the kids handled it okay.
Yeah, I mean, they showed up for class. They were, obviously required to be on screen for class. But we offered other sort of community building online events that they attended,
Okay, so it worked.
They
elected
to. Yeah, it worked.
Kids are adaptable. It's the adults I worry about.
Yeah.
I'm not sure about that. What's happening? What do we see for the 21-22 school year? Are we going to be masks, no masks? What's happening?
Well, we will be fully in person.
So
that's our plan.
That's not going to be virtual. Campus is open.
We obviously, we'll be abiding by social distancing. We still have all of our signs up. Hand washing stations. We'll be encouraging students to do that. We have a lot of outside space as well that teachers can use for teaching or lunch.
I used to see them under the tree, it seemed like when I drove by.
Yes. We have some nice outdoor space.
Yeah,
So we'll be utilizing that as well. As far as masks go, we are only high school, so grades 9 through 12. All of our staff are vaccinated.
Okay.
A large majority of our students are vaccinated, so that is helpful as well. We know everyone's had the opportunity to be vaccinated if they've chosen to. This could change, but our plan is, we will encourage masks, especially for students who aren't vaccinated.
Do you have to get vaccinated at your school and have to wear a mask?
Not at this point in time. If there's not a vaccine mandate, we'll wait till there's more guidance from the State Board of Education or
We're all waiting for the bombshell on the 16th of August, so, right? What the state superintendent says for public schools, and I guess maybe then the governor will chime in, so sure. It will be interesting.
Right. Yeah, I mean, we, for the most part, during this whole thing, we've you know, followed CDC guidelines, we've followed the recommendations, and, you know, we'll continue to do that. Or tweak it to how it works for our building
so
and our population.
What the community is telling you to do.
We are, and we're mindful of it. I think, it, you know, it's hard to say a month from now exactly what will be happening, because we just don't know. So you know, we've told our families, we've told our staff to this is our plan for opening, and this is what
Fingers
our plan
crossed.
For masking.
Yeah.
And but something could change, right? In 2 weeks, 3 weeks, something could change.
And I think aside from COVID too, it's a really exciting year because we have a new head of school.
Oh yeah, but okay.
Yeah, Stephanie Falaire, and she is just.
And make sure you know Stephanie can come on anytime she wants.
We will.
Friday
we will. That's very
11,
nice.
She put up with me, all right.
That's great. Yeah, she would love to. But she's just bringing an abundance of excitement and good energy.
Well, we have a new superintendent at the public level. You got a new head of the school. Should be fine. We're going to get the whole gang on here. We've got. Eventually, we'll get Stephanie come on. We'll get the public school board of ed, the president of college. We'll just brainstorm an education here because, like I said, I think the next couple of years are going to be wild. Hey, a question I've always wanted to know: who governs your school? In terms, is there a board that governs your school?
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
me too.
Tell me about that.
Yes, we do. We have a board of trustees.
Okay. Are they locals or who are they?
They all are local. I mean, it's Eastern Shore. Some are Eastern Shore. Some are Western Shore.
Right.
But we've got, I believe, 12 now, 12 trustees.
It's like the Board of Ed, except it's your board.
Yeah,
yeah,
okay, yeah, and they're wonderfully supportive in every way, and we're very fortunate to have them.
Are there public meetings? If someone's at home saying, you know what, here's some questions I have. Mm-hmm. Who should apply and when should they? I mean, can you still...
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Now?
We are still, we're
well,
actively...
Walking through this, if someone's at home saying, you know, these women have made a very good presentation, who, in terms of a student, mm-hmm. if I'm a parent, what type of student should apply?
Well, that's
Is that a fair question?
Yeah, that's a good question. Well, first of all, if you have a child or a student that is kind of struggling in school, whether it's just executive function or anxiety or anything that's just making their school experience challenging.
Okay.
We always encourage you to just come in and tour, and you know, we've got a big process to kind of go through and make sure that student is the right fit for us and or we're the right fit for them better. So yeah, that's always the place to start, but anybody is welcome to just come see the school
now,
and see if it feels
you
right.
You have your own website?
We do.
Wyeriverupperschool.org. Let me say it one more time.
Wyeriverupperschool.org.
Now, they'll kind of walk them through the steps if they say, you know what, I think this might be a need for me. How about can people call up and say, hey, I'd like to come visit?
Absolutely. Yeah. Anybody
is
welcome.
Who do they call and what number?
Well, I would be a good person to call, but just call our front desk.
Well, give me, do you have a number?
Do I remember? I think it's 410-758-2922.
And if not, it's on the website.
Right? It is on the website. If I got it wrong, it's on the website. But I believe it's
410-758-2922. I can't give you my phone number.
Got it. I think that's right.
give it one more time with an asterisk by that.
410-758-2922.
Ask for anyone in particular or just the
Our role? Lovely, she's now the executive assistant, Zara Cowan will answer and... She's a lovely person to talk to. Call anytime.
And say, I would like to get my son or daughter in this year. Can I get the ball
so
rolling?
So that would be our admissions or our enrollment director, Tracy Spence. She handles all the enrollment. But if you're just kind of wondering who's the right person to talk to for whatever need, just call our front desk and we'll direct you.
And there is still time.
There is still time, absolutely. Absolutely.
Oh, good. Okay, which is good. I'm sure there are a lot of parents out there, especially I hear more and more from parents. I don't have anything against public schools, but I just don't like the numbers.
Right.
A smaller environment might be better, and it might be because of COVID. It might be their working conditions or whatever. So this gives them an alternative. And look, we want as many alternatives for the children as we can get. Right. I don't care if it's public or private. We'd like them in school. Let me ask you this. Crystal ball, besides that, I think it's going to be extremely challenging. Where is Wye River Upper School headed in the future? Are we going to get bigger? Are we going to stay at 50 forever? Or is there one day it'll be 100 or one day two? Is there a plan?
Well,
what do you? This is a magic wand and a crystal ball. You're faking the whole thing.
I think numbers-wise, we do have room to grow a little bit, and you know, but our plan is really not to be a large school.
Okay, we like the small.
A small community, and so we have a little bit of room for growth.
Okay.
But again, we want to stay small, so you'll never see us.
Get that special attention.
At 100, 200, you know, students, that's not really our goal.
Okay.
Our plan. And, you know, we've got a lot of creative minds. I think bringing in the Makerspace building was a big goal, and that's been accomplished, and we're seeing great things, and so I think, you know, in the future, we can see, you know, different expansion of opportunities and programs for our students.
Yeah. If I gave you unlimited funds, I just won a lot. It was a couple of million. What would the Wye River? So, I mean, do you foresee in the future another building on that site or going somewhere? I mean, we're having fun. This is make believe.
Yeah,
just like the Board of Ed wants to have a new building out here. Taxpayers are saying, that's really bad.
Right.
I'm going to leave that question for Stephanie to answer because she is coming in with her very thoughtful, clear vision.
Okay.
But I will say right now, where it stands, the biggest need is just financial aid because nobody is immune to these effects of COVID.
Sure,
and
sure.
We are just seeing that the families and their financial needs are pretty high. So right now, if you were to give me that, I would give all the students the access to the education they need.
If someone's out there and says, you know, this is really a great concept, can they make contributions to the school?
Absolutely, they
can. Again, using your magic phone number or website, who would they contact?
You'd contact myself, which is Emma.
I just gave you six more jobs today, I promise.
Oh, it's wonderful. We're just happy for people to know about us. But my direct line is 8291. I'm sorry.
Okay, do it one more time.
443-262-8291.
Okay, and just simply say, I would like to make some type of comment. Now, if people want to, do you take volunteers in terms I would like to help with lunch duty or
And we are entering our 20th anniversary year.
Oh, wow, okay.
So there is an abundance of need for volunteers and contributions.
If mom and pop or retired teachers sitting at home and say, you know what? I'd like to do that. What do you need?
Well, you know, we're in the very early stages. We are really launching our 20th year, January 1st. Mm-hmm. But we are going to have multiple events. So something for everybody, kind of a family fun sort of day and a more formal event. And so with any event, there's just so much need for help.
So you need people to help set up tables. You need people probably to cook food. You need people to help run them, some type of event. Almost like a gala, right?
Yeah, and that'll come later. I mean, right now, we're really just kind of gathering our student stories, and I think this is such a great opportunity for our school because we really are a stepping stone for their next pathway, and that's so a part of our mission is taking each student and finding out what the best path for them is because all of our students are not college-bound. Many of them are, but not all of them are. Some of them are going to thrive in a trade school setting or military. So it's really exciting to just kind of share these transformative stories because they really are all transformative stories. I mean, they are totally different students when they leave than the students that came in.
Let me follow up on that. I know what parents are going to ask you, I would think, is, so what happens to my kid when they leave the upper school? What are your numbers looking like for college and trade school and military? Sure. I mean, we find a place to go after we leave?
We work individually with our students towards their goals and helping them to find what might be the best fit for them after high school, whether it's a best fit college experience or community college or a best fit training or apprentice type program. We do have a diverse group of, you know, student goals and student needs.
So everything from college to the military to everything in between, right?
Everything, everything.
And you help them develop their plan for that, yes?
We do. And I would add, we would welcome any local business people that would like to come in and talk to our students about their careers and their experiences, or if they'd like to give a tour. So I want to bring students here to get a tour and understand the inner workings of your studio.
So you'd like to have a CPA, you'd like to have a doctor, somebody come in and talk to kids about their jobs.
Or host someone, if they're willing to host a couple of students for even a few hours, just to say, hey, this, you know, you're interested in this field of study, let me kind of show you what's involved. So
there's a plan. Not only is there while they're there, but you're going to send them somewhere.
Yeah,
and when they walk out the door.
That's such a big part of why we have so many different aspects of our program is so that they can kind of get their feet wet in mm-hmm. a lot of different areas and see what's striking a passion with them. And it really often does start at that school. They discover, you know what, I love music and I thought I'd be afraid to sing in front of people, but I did it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, or whatever it may be, your makerspace has culinary skills and sewing and woodworking and metalworking, anything. Okay. So they really get a lot of experience. And, you know, another thing I think is really unique that for our musicals and whatnot, the students run all the sound and lighting, and that's a skill you often don't get.
But yeah, you have musicals.
Yes, we do.
You do it in the armory. What have you had recently?
I do.
So, we live in town, we didn't know it. It's our fault, not your fault.
So I think that the last performance pre-COVID was Cinderella.
Yep.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
And they performed the Wizard of Oz.
Oh, wow.
As well. So they're not always musicals, but the last couple were.
So a play or something.
A play or musical. And
since Broadway was closed down, you were probably
so, yeah, we can,
for a while, right?
So we anticipate having one this year. I don't have all the details for when and and the performance yet.
But the kids have a chance.
Yeah, anybody can try. And that's one of these transformative stories I talk about. That's one of the biggest things to witness is that they come in very anxious socially. Mm-hmm. Very anxious. They don't want to talk in front of anybody, but then they try and they get up and they love it and they really are great.
It happens so fast.
So
how about, you have any artists in the school? You have any,
we have lots of artists.
Do you have like an art show every year or anything?
We do.
Okay.
We do. We
have time of year normally?
It's in the spring. It's our art expo, and it usually happens sort of alongside the spring performances. So we have musical performances and a gallery show in the building as well, which is usually open for the public. So
the kids really have an awful lot of opportunities, don't they? Now, ladies, we only have a couple minutes left. That half an hour wasn't bad. I always ask everybody, whether county commissioner ever who comes in the show, and I'll give you a couple seconds to think about, what's the best part of the job working at Wye River Upper School? Obviously, it's the students, and but is there one or two things, the art shows, is there something that just you say to the parents, by God, this is why it makes this school great? Mm-hmm. Is there one event? It might be a tough question, but is there something, it might be just a special care of the kids, it sounds like, a family environment.
I would say it's every day, just the community.
All right. The everyday environment. And caring.
I've been in small communities, and I love small communities, and ours is really unique.
Okay.
It's just really tight-knit and supportive, and it's amazing how naturally it happens for the students. It seems like they come with this understanding of their pasts, and so they're empathetic and open to everyone they meet, and it's just really a really loving place.
Good. Yeah. If I'm a parent, hey, that sounds good to me, right? Toughest thing is parents, you know, remember the first day of kindergarten, those of you have gone through that, The kids just getting on the bus. They're ready to go, but mom and dad are sitting there crying. Oh, I'm giving money. It's trying to be nice to go to a place where you really get a loving environment.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. How about yourself?
I agree with Katie. Okay. I'll also add, one of the things I really love to see is our students take risks.
Okay.
And they're comfortable doing it. And we all know it's really hard. It's hard for us to take risks, right? And put yourself out of your comfort zone. And I love it when I see a student who's never played sports before say, okay, and get out there on the soccer field and play competitive high school soccer for the first time in their lives and love it. Or same thing, never performed before, but never probably thought that they would. But here they are on stage. And whether they love it or they just like their experience is fine, but they're taking risks. And that
gives them some self-confidence.
That's like the favorite part, I think, of my week at school is when I see students doing things like that.
Well, good.
Yeah. And for me, I think it's being able to kind of tell these student stories and also the feedback and the testimonials from parents and just the relief that they have knowing that their child is in an inclusive, safe, nurturing, rigorous environment. It's really a beautiful thing to see that comfort from them.
It makes it easier to go to work, too, right? Now, everyone watching the show, remember we've been talking about the Wye River Upper School. If they have questions, now take 30 seconds, remember our phone number, okay, we can go to a website. Yes. And the website is?
WyeRiverUpperSchool.org.
Okay, and that probably is going to answer 90% of your questions, like most websites. Mm-hmm. If we just watch this and say, you know what, I'm ready, let's get the ball rolling. They should call
410-758-2922.
Batting two for two here. Now you're on a roll. Okay. If they'd just like to visit, same number or where is
that? Same number, yeah. You can call and we'll direct you to the right person if you have a different need. But yeah. Well,
thank you all for coming out today. I mean, it's 95 degrees out there. The air is terrible. They're stuck in here. At least it's cool.
It's nice. Yeah.
Look, have a wonderful school year. And like I say to all my educators, you're doing the most important job in the world. I don't care what anybody says. So. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
My name's Fred McNeil. Thank you for watching QACTV7. My time's up. Thank you for your time. We're going to see you next time.